cafe. As you all know, there is no prophet in his hometown. Well, this is my hometown, so even if I sound like one, I know it. Idea today is really just to have fun, unadulterated fun, unadulterated, that means no math. If I have any math, you stop me right away. You know, maybe what I call math and what you call math is different, you know. And basically, the basic idea, if you're going to have half as much fun as I do, then I'm going to have twice as much fun as you do. Right? Okay, no math. This is no math. Okay, so I work in two places, in Yale University and University of Connecticut. The math is very simple. I spend 4 days a week at Yale, 4 days a week at UConn, and in the other 2 days, it depends, you know. I'm sure you all know about Yale, this little college in New England that started right up here, you know, just like here in this corner. It wasn't Yale at that time. Elihu Yale came much, much later. But do you know about this wonderful place called Avery Point? This is where my lab is when I'm at Avery Point. Just right down the street over here, I-95, or up I-95. And come to Avery Point, and I really recommend you send your kids to this. There's only about 800 students there, so it's an atmosphere of a small college with the backing of a huge university, University of Connecticut, 26,000 people. You can come to my school by car, by train, by airplane, but most important thing, you can come by boat, you can sail, you can park over here, come to my lab. I warn you, if you come, you may not want to leave. It's such a beautiful place. Okay, so what we would like to discuss today is this great revolution that came upon us by one wonderful telescope called the Hubble Space Telescope. Well, you cannot see it, but if you pay $295, and let's see, that was March 11, 1995. Then you would have this story of the Hubble Space Telescope on Time magazine. And of course, the question, one of the questions that we would like, all of us would like to know, is where did the universe begin, you know? Was it 5,771 years, or was it 13.8 billion years ago? And if it is one, how can we reconcile it with the other? And you can see that today we're actually going to probe some of these questions. I mean, really the heart of the question, of the first question that civilization asked. How did it all start? You know, was there first a night? Was there first a morning? What happened? So this is one of these beautiful picture that the Hubble Space Telescope gave us of an object which we will learn later. It's called Messier 100. We catalog those objects. And we will see later why and how. And this is a galaxy which we could never see with this wonderful clarity. This all came from the Hubble. The time didn't ask at that time, but I would like to ask today, what is the universe made of? You know, what are we all made of? How do we come to be? And the question that we will see later, which is related, how large is the universe, is actually related to how old is the universe. All of this came, the answer came from Hubble, Hubble Space Telescope. So here it is. Here is the space telescope. These are the solar power collector. And here is the telescope. There is a mirror over here. And everything gets sent. But curiously enough, in this picture, it's pointing toward the Earth. Well, let me tell you a secret. The Hubble Space Telescope actually, originally, before we had a telescope looking up to the space, we had telescopes which were built by the military, which were like the Hubble Space Telescope. Remember, we wanted to see everything about those damn Russians. We wanted to see them in their bedroom. We wanted to see every little detail, what the Russians are up to. So for years, we developed the technology for the Hubble Space Telescope. But none of us knew Those guys, you know, the president probably saw all these very beautiful pictures of them driving in their cars, etc. All of them were developed by a technology that later somebody said, oh, now that we look so good on the Earth, why don't we buy another telescope, $2 billion, and turn it to the sky, turn it to the heavens, turn it to the stars, and look at the stars. So this is how the Hubble Space Telescope started. In fact, it started because we developed this technology to spy on the Russian. Here is Mr. Edwin Hubble. Okay? He's sitting over here in a telescope. This is a telescope called 200-inch Hale telescope. Hale was a great man from Chicago who built, the Adler Planetarium. He built a lot of things, gave a lot of money for science. 200-inch, what is 200-inch? 200-inch is 5 meters. So every telescope has a mirror, is a parabolic mirror. The radius of it is 5 meters. So 5 meters, like from here to the pillar over there. That's the mirror that collects the light that then the telescope views. So we always define the telescope by the inch of the, how many inch or how many meters is the mirror. So here is Edwin Hubble sitting in this Mount Palomar telescope, Mount Palomar Observatory. So it's on Mount Palomar, the observatory is on Mount Palomar in California, in the 200-inch Hale telescope. Mount Palomar is where he did his later work. His original work was all done at Mount Wilson. In fact, if you go to Pasadena, Caltech, you just drive, beautiful drive up the mountain, you go to Mount Wilson and you can see the actual telescope that Hubble used. In fact, during the day they put on display the very chair that Hubble used to sit on, and you can imagine the man sitting over there with a pipe, hopefully not smoking the pipe, smoke is not good for telescope, and looking at the sky. At night, they're still using that telescope, okay? During the day, it is a museum that you can all go and see, and I really recommend you do. It's really a beautiful thing. So here is Mr. Edwin Hubble. What you see is what you get. A man with zero sense of humor, but a great scientist. In fact, originally, he wasn't going to be a scientist. He was going to be a lawyer. He went to World War I. Remember, we're talking about 1920s. World War I, came back from the war and found himself and decided to be a scientist and made, I would say, one of the greatest revolutions in science of our time. Certainly the most significant revolution. So, the first thing that we're going to be concerned in this little discussion is no coffee. I don't drink coffee, I don't care, so it's all right. Is scales, okay? How large is the universe? And how do we measure things? You see, at home, if I want to measure something, I go to my wife and say, can you give me the measuring tape? Can you give me a yardstick? And I put the yardstick and I put it 5 times and I know that the yardstick is 1 yard. That's why it's called yardstick. So if I put it 5 times, it's 5 yard, right? How do I do it in astronomy? I have 2 problems. I don't have a yardstick which is long enough to reach from here to there. And second, I cannot go and put it here and put it there. How do I measure distances? Okay? We'll come back to this. But we know that, for example, the Earth, the nearest star to the Earth, funny enough, if we don't call it a star, we call it a sun. But it's a star. There's, in fact, 100 billion suns, 100 billion stars like the sun in our very own galaxy, the Milky Way. Okay? So we decided, so close to us, we'll give it another name. But it's just mainstream. There's, you know, you point to the sky and you'll see 100 billion of them. Okay? It is about 149 million kilometers. Okay? So the distance from here to my home is about 2 kilometers, 3 kilometers. Now we're talking about 1 million kilometers and 149 of them. Really far. If you are a flash of light and you're moving from the sun to Earth, it takes you 8 minutes. So we now measure distances by the speed of light. So the distance from the Earth to the Sun is 8 light minutes. That is the distance that light travels in 8 minutes. Okay? 8 light minutes. We call this distance one astronomical unit. Where is the next star? The next star is hopelessly far away from us. It's in fact in the southern hemisphere. This is north. It's in the southern hemisphere. And it's called Alpha Centauri. In fact, Alpha Centauri is a three-star system. Alpha Centauri Proxima, which evolves around Alpha Centauri A, and both of them evolve around Alpha Centauri B. It takes light to travel 4.2 years from Alpha Centauri to the Earth. Therefore, we call the distance 4.2 light years. Okay, this is the way we're going to measure these distances in terms of light year. Astronomers use another unit, parsecs, so we are not going to use it. But sometimes you will see on my slide parsecs. So 3.2 light year is one parsec. I try to always talk about light year. So light year is the distance that light travels in 1 year. Well, when we drive our car, we drive less than 1/1,000,000th of the speed of light. So if we were to drive with our car from the Earth to Alpha Centauri, the trip is going to be more than 1,000,000 years. Imagine spending 1,000,000 years with kids in the car waiting to arrive to Alpha Centauri. Okay? In other words, the universe is hopelessly empty. There's nothing there. I mean, our next door neighbor is 4.2 light year. If we're going to travel anytime soon to some other stars, it's going to be hopelessly long. We are hopelessly alone, you know, and the universe is hopelessly empty. Nothing happens around here. Okay? Well, the next distance that we will be interested in is the distances of the Milky Way. Here is our own galaxy, the Milky Way. You know that bright thing that you see across the star? It's just one of these spiral arms. We are just looking at that when we are looking up to the sky. That thing that goes across the sky is just part of the Milky Way. With the naked eye, we can see roughly on a clear day, cold winter day, when there's not much activity in the atmosphere, we can see roughly 5,000 stars, okay? Remember, there are 100 billion. Most of them are here, which we can never even reach. When we are looking over here. So the Milky Way. The Milky Way, maybe I have to just move it just a little bit, because the edge, perfect, huh? The Milky Way is 100,000 light year. Remember, our next door neighbor was 4 light year. Now we're talking about 100,000, less than 1,000,000 light year. That's the size of the Milky Way. We know it pretty good. Hubble knew it. They knew it before Hubble. Here's how the Milky Way looks. This is a picture that was taken by, I guess it's politically incorrect to say mankind, so people kind, okay? We took a picture of our own galaxy. It's not the Hubble, it's another satellite called COBE. That's a picture of our own galaxy. Here's our own galaxy, it has a core. We are sitting over here. The solar system is inclined at about 30 degrees with respect to the galaxy, our own galaxy, the Milky Way. And in the center of our galaxy, the Milky Way, there is a black hole, which we will not talk about. You're welcome to ask me about it. And that black hole weighs like 1,000,000 suns. Okay? That's what put our galaxy together. That is in the constellation Sagittarius, and we call it Sagittarius A star. So we are inclined by about 30 degrees to the Milky Way. The Earth